I don't want to set the world on fire. I just want to start a flame in your heart. In my heart I have but one desire, and that one is you. No other will do.
Hello, this is my project to restore Model T as well as convert it to electric energy. Hope you enjoy.
So I had managed to ruin the audio of the video that I had put together. And of course, I put the video together after I sold the vehicle. So I'm going to record new audio, which is what I'm doing now. And I'm going to basically tape over the footage with it and to get the video. So right now I'm just going through the car. The car's name that I gave it is Seabiscuit, which is what the previous owner had named it. And I wanted to keep it the same. And now we're looking inside the vehicle. On the steering column, you can see two levers, which are original to the car. On the right is actually basically the throttle. And on the left, surprisingly, unless you're familiar with Model Ts, is the timing lever, which is what was used to actually time the internal combustion engine. And that really became obsolete quickly, and was only used a little while later on, like, tractors, but not so much cars. That red lever is basically the brake lever, and which is how the car stops. And you can see basically a cigarette lighter, or the port for cigarette lighter, a voltmeter. And then over here, I've actually had two shift levers, and that's just how I made it work. I couldn't just make one. I had to use two shift levers just to kind of get it to work with the transmission. Up there is the key switch. You don't have a lot of options as far as electronics in the original car. You can choose basically lights or no lights. And then if you look very closely, you can actually see a battery selection and a magneto selection. You could run a Model T off either a 6-volt battery or a magneto that was built into the engine, which is really cool. So you could have run a Model T without a battery, kind of similar to how some outboard engines run with a magneto. I guess that's just the key. On the right, you can see an original, well, probably not original to the car, but it would have been there originally, an amp meter to basically tell you how much current's being drawn while you operate the vehicle, and that is not wired into the new electronics. All right, so moving down, I think I'm just going to cover this very briefly here. Just basically an auxiliary dash panel with a BMS battery management system, or the display of it, and then a master on off for the 72 volt battery. And then I've got three switches which are wired to various accessories. And then on the left, I've got a buzzer and a small LED indicator, which alerts if there's something wrong with the battery. And I think I'm going to come back to that later in the video. So moving to the front of the car, I've got the wheel, as you can probably see. I guess one of the cool things about that is the wooden spokes, which was done away with in I think the mid-20s, and they were replaced with metal wire wheels. So going into the engine area, or I guess the motor area now, you can see the electric motor, which is a 72 volt D&D electric motor bolted to a Borg Ward, kind of a rare German luxury vehicle manufacturer, a Borg Ward 4-speed transmission. I found that in a barn and the price was right. That's why I have it. No other reason other than it's a manual. which made things a lot simpler. Up here, that's actually the original wiring. Obviously not an original fuse block. I added that because the Model T originally had absolutely no fuses. I guess you could think of the wires as the fuse. And so if something were to burn, it would be the wires. So I didn't really like that, so I added a fuse block. Original horn. I try to keep the original wiring intact and just work my way around it with the new wiring. There you have motor controller and the master contactor. Up here, I have where you plug in to charge the battery, the new battery that is, and it just takes a simple 120 volt American house wiring plug or extension cord. You can see that's where you plug it in. It's very simple. So it doesn't take any special voltage or special wiring to charge the vehicle, which I liked. It does take about, I believe it was 6 or 7 hours to fully charge, which is that's a considerable amount of time. In the front, 20 is on the radiator. That's the year I graduated high school, which is the year that I made the video. Down there is the hand crank, which would have been original to start the engine of a Model T. And you would just crank it over until it started. There was a very particular way to do it so you wouldn't break your arm if the engine backfired, which happened, which was a common occurrence. The lights, and then working around the car. That, I guess you could think of it as a trunk. That's where you would put your trunk, opening the door. You can see new door panels. Those were fun to make. Okay, so now I'm going back to the display with better lighting. If it zooms in correctly, you'll be able to see the voltage of the battery, the amp hours of the battery, the watt hours, the on the left bottom corner, the amperage usage, which since the car is not moving, it's zero. And the voltage at the moment is about 75 volts. And the numbers below the voltage are 3.7, and that represents each basically bank of cells. And then, so those are all the banks of cells. I guess I went way too fast through that, but yeah, that's pretty specific and not interesting to most people. I still have a 12 volt car battery wired in. That's the voltmeter for it. That's the GPS system. And yeah, I guess we're going to the bed, which I made out of wood, obviously, as you can see. Yeah, the bed was just too far gone to restore, and it also allowed me to have a nice spot to stow the two batteries and some more electronics. So I'm opening that up now. So wrapped up in about 20 rolls of electrical tape is the master battery. I guess I'm looking at the 12 volt battery right now. And that's just to run things like the lights, the switch, the original switch, and the original wiring still runs off that 12 volt battery. This is the 72 volt battery. The blue box that's taped up is the BMS system, which is wired into that display. Yeah, I used about, I think, 540 lithium-ion cells, which are very energy-dense. So that battery, while it weighs maybe, I think it was 40 or 50 pounds, maybe the approximate weight of one good-sized car battery, has the capacity of about, I think, 6 or 7 car batteries. So it's extremely energy-dense. Yes. Over there, I have another master cutoff, because the battery is so energy dense that if anything happened at all, you'd want to be able to very quickly shut off power to it. Yeah, and now we are driving down the road, and I'm going to leave it to the video now. Thank you.
All right, so I'm now going to go over some history about the Model T, in which there is quite a lot. So it all begins with the Ford Motor Company, which was founded in 1903 by two partners, Alexander Malcolmson and Henry Ford. Most people know Ford, but not so much Malcolmson, and we'll get into that later. Ford was born in the early 1860s and would go on to work in many professions, including as a machinist and a steam engine repairman. Throughout his life, Ford had a pretty serious passion for mechanically powered vehicles. He was fascinated by the idea of a lightweight vehicle that could hold, you know, one to maybe up to four or five people, you know, powered by a light engine, not so much like a heavy-duty steam tractor or anything of that like. Starting in 1892, Ford would begin to build his own cars in his home workshop. In 96, he built his first, you know, official vehicle, which was known as the quadricycle. The quadricycle was essentially an extremely light-duty car with four bicycle wheels and a very light engine, maybe just a couple horsepower. I think it could hold one or two people. But that was really one of the first automobiles. And of course, he would only make just a handful of these, you know, no more than, you know, five or six total in the span of, you know, a couple years. So Malcolmson, on the other hand, was a coal dealer by profession. This was his primary profession. His passion was really not in building automobiles. The reason why Malcolmson was, you know, involved in the Ford Motor Company was really just to financially back Ford and hopefully make some money off of it too. So the two partners, they needed some finances for this company. You know, they wanted to produce these cars, so they needed the money to do it. So they needed some financial backers. So Ford had already started a previous company, which he left. So many people were afraid to financially back Ford, you know, in the belief that he would just leave the company again. So it was really Malcolmson that helped get the 10 additional financial backers or stock owners for the Ford Motor Company. The largest stock owner, other than Ford and Malcolmson, would be John Gray, a very respectable person at the time. Gray would also be the first president of the company. So in 1903, they began production. The early years proved to be very successful for the young company. In 1906, Malcolmson left due to a kind of dispute over where the company should be going. And that's sort of the end of Malcolmson in relationship to the Ford Motor Company. He would go on to start his own motor company called Aero Car, which you probably haven't heard of because it wasn't very successful. He started that in 1906, and I think it went bankrupt just a couple years later. That same year of 1908, unfortunately, John Gray would die unexpectedly. This left Ford as the acting president. So now Ford lost his partner, and he lost, you know, the primary, or really the third most serious financial backer. So this really left Ford as the president. So between the years of 1903 and 1907, the company would produce multiple models, each with an alphabetical letter from A in 1903 to the S in 1907. Yes, the Model A in 1903. There was a previous Model A to the car most people know. In 1907, Ford began to kind of gear his workshops for a new model vehicle, which would be the Model T. His goal with this car was to produce it at a cost any man with a decent salary could afford, and he wanted it built with the simplest design so anyone could work on it. And that's pretty much exactly what he did. So the first full year of production would be 1908, and he sold almost 10,000 cars, which was quite remarkable. So after those, you know, 10,000 cars were sold, you know, people had a demand, they grew a demand for the Model T. They liked the simplicity and they liked the cost of the Model T. In addition to that, there were many body styles that were offered for the T, including a roadster pickup, which is basically a truck, you know, a two-door, four-door, kind of like a family vehicle, and so on. So as demand grew and grew, Ford needed a way how to cut costs and build these Model Ts at a very quick rate. This kind of birthed the assembly line. So Ford's success in the assembly line came for multiple reasons, the largest of which was just the simplicity of this assembly line. You know, you'd have one man doing one job for, you know, multiple hours so he could really, you know, get that job down and kind of be the best at it. Another reason was Ford would pay his workers, I believe it was almost double what any other car company was willing to pay. This created a large, you know, interest in working for Ford, and, you know, happy workers, you know, more productivity. And obviously that was very successful. So the Model T would have been produced between 1908 and 1927. And within that time frame, they produce over 15 million cars. Truly an automotive success. So by 1907, Ford wanted to re-gear his shops for a new model vehicle, the Model A, the second Model A. And then right after the Model T was starting to be produced, the Great Depression hit, which had really devastating effects for all companies. And, you know, just to represent this, of 200 car manufacturers in the United States in 1920, only 17 were left by 1940. Ford was one of them.
Into each life some rain must fall, but too much is falling in mine. Into each heart some tears must fall, but someday the sun will shine. Some folks can lose the blues in their hearts, but when I think of you, another shower starts. Into each life some rain must fall, but too much is falling in mine.
Into each life some rain must fall, but too much is falling in mine. Into each heart some tears must fall, but someday the sun will shine. Some folks can lose the blues in their hearts, but when I think of you, another shower starts. Into each life some rain must fall, but much is falling in mine.
Into each and every life some rain has got to fall, but too much of that stuff has fallen into mine. And into each heart some tears has got to fall, but I know that someday that sun is bound to shine.
Some folks can lose the blues in their hearts,
but when I think of you, another shower starts. Into each life some rain must fall, but too much is falling.
I say I'll move the mountains, and I'll move the mountains. If he wants them out of the way, crazy he calls me. Sure, I'm crazy, crazy in love, I'd say. I say I'll go through fire, and I'll go through fire as he wants it, so it will be. Crazy he calls me. Sure I'm crazy, crazy in love, you see. Like the wind that shakes the bough, he moves me with a smile. The difficult I'll do right now, the impossible will take a little while. I say I'll care forever, and I mean forever, if I have to hold up the sky. Crazy he calls me. Sure I'm crazy, crazy in love, am I?
Yippee-yay, there'll be no wedding bells for today. Cause I got spurs.